In the third session, we have with us Dr. Pradeep M. K. Nair, who is the professor and head of research, Sant Hiridharam Medical College for Naturopathy and Yogic Sciences for Women, Bhopal. He will be addressing us on the topic, Naturopathy Interventions, a Salutogenic Approach for COVID-19. Welcome yourself for this session. To introduce Dr. Pradeep Nair to all of you, all the participants, Dr. Nair is a professor and head of research at Sant Hiridharam Medical College of Naturopathy and Yogic Sciences for Women, Bhopal, and he's also the director of Indian Academy for Scientific Writing and Research, Pune. He was the first head of the Research and Development Department of the National Institute of Naturopathy, a part of Government of India, and has worked in various collaborative research projects with institutes of repute. He is one of the renowned researchers in the field of naturopathy and yoga, who has authored nearly 30 research papers in peer-reviewed international journals, as well as written 23 chapters in national and international textbooks. He's also the editor for the textbook of Clinical Naturopathy and Yoga. He has served as editorial board member for nearly 14 international journals, and he was awarded as the youth icon for the year 2017 by the Indian Naturopathy and Yoga Graduates Medical Association, INIGMA, for his contributions to the field of research in yoga and naturopathy. It's a pleasure to have you, sir, with us.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sankita, for that warm introduction.
Yeah, just I would like to add one more thing. All of you should know that for the first time across the globe, from India, we are going to have Indian Journal of Yoga and Naturopathy. So in that, the credit goes to CCRYM team, again Dr. Raghavendra Rao, director of CCRYM, and Dr. Pradeep Nair also is one of the editorial member. So we congratulate Dr. Pradeep to be part of this editorial team. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So this time, I thought we will speaking on naturopathic interventions, a salutogenic approach for COVID-19. For many of you, the term salutogenesis will be a newer term, but this is the basics of our yoga and naturopathy per se when you look at it as a holistic system of medicine. I'm very sure the speakers before me might have conveyed about the importance of yoga interventions in COVID-19, and also there is one more speaker who will be speaking on that. So our focus will be majorly on these naturopathic interventions and how it can be integrated in this COVID-19, as well as beyond that, and how we should be prepared enough for the upcoming infections or upcoming diseases which we are staring at. So if you see, since most of you are from the first year, you might be into your PNC subjects which you'll be doing. And those PNC subjects which you are learning about the great philosophies of naturopathy or the philosophers in naturopathy, these are nothing new. If you start with 460 BC, where Hippocrates, who is regarded as a father of medicine, he has already told what is being discussed extensively by the modern naturopaths like us. Like, the natural force within each one of us is the greatest force which will help us in getting well, and mostly mediated by the food as well as exercise and the rest. And this together produce health. And if you see 460 BC, though he is regarded as the father of medicine, they have been speaking more about health. But of late, we have become a disease-centric physicians, where we seldom speak about health. And health is something which is untouchable, and we cannot speak for hours together on health, and whether we are very comfortable in speaking about disease. And it is not only medicos, if you see, for that matter, any kind of people who are gathering in a function or who are gathering in a place, they have enough number of things to discuss about their diabetes, discuss about their hypertension, or discuss about even COVID-19, which is the latest trend. And when we switch on TV, there is lot many news. When you open the paper, there are lot many news coming about this particular COVID-19 and its related impact on human health, as well as socioeconomic factors. So naturopathy per se as a system of medicine, or yoga and naturopathy as a system of medicine, never speak extensively about disease, whereas we are always been a health-centric community, a health-centric medical system, but it has been often diluted by the hearsay evidences or the force with which the modern medical literature is being pushed to us. However, it doesn't mean that there are no counteractive or counterproductive medical literature available, which speaks about more of health. But those literature are very lessly promoted, and those literature we never refer to also. So once you move ahead in your career, in your first year, second year, and third year, so in the first year where you read a lot about physiology, you'll be convinced about the body's function and the wisdom with which the body function is designed with. But when we go into the second year and we take pathology as a subject, the physiology slowly start diminishing in our brain and pathology dominates, because we always fascinate of being a doctor by seeing a modern medical doctor. There is no problem in fascinating in that way. However, we should use that to our benefit. We hardly looks into our philosophy, and most of our naturopathy philosophies are ignored or forgotten while we start a medical practice. It is a common blame among all of us. And this is very detrimental for the growth of the system. Like when you see any concepts or any kind of mechanism, when we put a fan or when we put a light, there should be a philosophy behind that. Similarly, when we put forward your system of medicine, yoga and naturopathy as a single system of medicine, while you propose forward, there should be some philosophy behind it. Even if you see the way yoga research is being done, the way naturopathy research is being done, it is something like there is no philosophy left in our research, where we just promote asana, pranayama, and meditation on one side. On the other side, we are more fascinated with individualistic therapies, like either a diet or a single diet or a single component of nutrition, or we are just promoting something like a hip bath or a spinal bath on an isolation, which is not what is mentioned in our textbooks. And so that we as a community has to readapt and readapt towards this change. And we have to bring in the much needed philosophical aspect to our practice. So since my topic is COVID-19 and naturopathy interventions today, so I thought the major fear factor which is spread over here is on germs. We are worried about the virus being more powerful than us. We are worried about we becoming vulnerable and get contracting to this viral infection. However, if you understand the naturopathic philosophy, or if you understand the philosophy of infectious disease per se, and if you see in my footnote, this Lancet publication from 1968, which speaks on limitations of germ theory. So those who are in first year, Lancet is one of the landmark medical journal which publishes modern medical articles. If you see practically all infections, whether it is common cold till smallpox, that are communicable diseases, almost all these practical infection-causing pathogens are present in our body. Most of them are dormant state, and it will become virulent or it will become more active, infectious, only when our body become a little vulnerable and when the virulence factor for this virus or bacteria or any kind of microorganisms become more dominant than our innate healing mechanisms. Otherwise, starting from tuberculosis, all of us have tuberculosis, irrespective of whoever is tuberculosis. In fact, Mycobacterium tuberculosis very much before than the humans came into this universe. So that is one of the first microorganisms to come into the world. So almost all the microorganisms are present in our body, and we cannot have a life without these microorganisms. Microorganisms are very intact and integral part of our ecosystem and our bodily environment as well. So germs as a causative organism for any infection was propagated and promoted when the germ theory of disease got very popular. And it is a convenient reductionist approach that germ causes disease. Germs are present at the disease scenario, and germs are something which is present in our normal body in a normal condition as well. It is up to us whether we need to promote this normally present microbial flora in our body, in all parts of our body, whether to promote that into a virulent pathogen or just to make that as a convenient co-host in our body. And the aggressive approach towards germs, in killing the germs or disinfecting the germs, is going to create more void in the atmosphere and more void in the environment. And when there is a void which is created, there will be creation of newer genes, how the evolution theory was created, like how we believe the Charles Darwin's theory of evolution, like from apes, how we have developed into a full-fledged human being. Every germs we kill there is a void created in that atmosphere and there is a new germs. We call it mutation in modern fancy scientific term. But everything you kill, there is a resistance strain created against this. So this is a normal balance of the ecosystem. And we, with our reductionist angle, or we with our biomedical angle, we look into this as, we name it in a new way. Once upon a time, we were naming it poliomyelitis for polio. Now it is non-polio related myelitis. That is the only change which we have achieved. And we are proud that we have eliminated polio. But in reality, it is not. We have eliminated one name and the newer names are coming. So we need to, as a student or as a doctor of yoga and naturopathy, we need to look into whether germs are really the causative organism for the disease. And we are getting that feeling that germs causes this disease because we are just holding Harsh Mohan, we are holding the pathogenic textbooks, pathology textbooks close to our hand, and our prevention and social medicine textbooks are away from our desk. So let me explain it a little more clearer for you. As I told, germs will become pathogen only when there is a favorable conditions for them. And if you see the COVID scenario, India is a 132 crore populated country. And the number of people infected with COVID-19 is 2.54 crores till last year, till last week. And the number of people died out of that is 3.54 lakhs. That is 1% of the total population who got infected by COVID-19. Why are we not speaking about 130 crore people who are not infected? And why we are not thinking about why they are not infected? So it is not the germs which has become suddenly become pathogens and started infecting us. There is a lot of transition going in our culture. If you see, this is published in Infection Ecology Epidemiology Journal in 2015, the consequences of human actions on risk of infectious diseases. It is not the germs which is per se coming and making, I am a pathogen, I'm more powerful than you. It is a human action. If you see, we have the environmental land degradation has happened in a lot, many ways. The sea levels are increasing. There is a higher increase in poverty. There is a lot of aging population due to our, sustainable medical equipments, which is available, which are promoting the aging, but the quality of life is decreasing. There is undernutrition and starvation. In India, the undernutrition rates are much higher. And in India, the global hunger index for India is ranked 94 among 107 countries. So we are almost 10 or 11 position from the back. And migration of people. Now we don't have, I am a Keralite, I am now in Madhya Pradesh. And somebody else from Tamil Nadu is working in Delhi. Somebody else from New Zealand is working in India. So there is migration of people. Along with that, there is migration of newer germs to the newer area. And there are newer populations, newer culture, newer recruitment of new vectors. And we are inducing transmission by irrational use of antibiotics. We are increasing the transmission and the mutation by using repeated type of vaccination doses. And we are not sure what is the surveillance of vaccination around us. The wildlife contact has increased. The forests are reducing. That's why we are seeing news, tiger is coming into the village. It is not the tiger coming into the village. Village has gone into the forest. So we have made ourselves more susceptible due to this network of changes. And all we concentrate is on decreased immunization and immunity, which you can see in my cursor, where my cursor is. And you have these many factors which we need to address before aggressively immunizing people and aggressively working on immunity. Immunity is not something which will be produced inside our body. Immunity should be carved from the environmental factors, from the physical factors, physiological factors, as well as community and individual factors. And I hope this session is recorded and it will be there in the YouTube. And all the yoga and naturopathy students should be reading these kind of papers to understand the complexity of health. Health is not as simple like that if there is an insulin receptor which is getting damaged, you are getting diabetes. Then almost all of us will be diabetic. Why that insulin receptor is getting damaged in a particular person? And is all the insulin receptor damage is going to create vulnerable situation like diabetes to people? Why lot many of the people are not getting infected while a few people are getting infected? So this kind of thinking, the complexity, the inclusivity of our thinking in the evolution of health need to be discussed. And this, I'm very happy like this is happening in your first year. This kind of culture should be inculcated from the very beginning of our medical career. Otherwise, we'll get spoiled along with our conventional thoughts about medical schooling, conventional thought of being a doctor. who will be sitting in a 4x4 room and consulting patients. We should get into the community and find what are those favorable conditions which we make the germs to become pathogenic, because germs are already there before us. We have changed the culture. We have changed the environment. So how naturopathy will be favorable in such kind of conditions, and how only naturopathy and yoga can be favorable in that conditions will be discussed by us. And if you see, immune system is not that simple. Then a single vaccination can offer protection for hundreds of people, 100% of people. And when you become a researcher, you can know how the data is presented to you. So the data which is presented to you, you is just attributable risk factor, which will be saying that is what they consider as the success of an immunization or a vaccination. But our immune system is not that simple. We cannot just concentrate on a single centric approach. Like you just find an antibody against a particular strain of virus. And now why we are not able to control this particular COVID-19 to a greater extent is because the virus has become more smarter. Within the span of 2 years, we have around 16 to 17 strains of virus from the same SARS-CoV family. So immune system is very complex and very fascinating. And if you see the surveillance study, the sero surveillance study, where they look for the antibodies. Last week, I have seen the sero surveillance studies from UK, which was released by the UK government. Around 75% to 80% of the people who are immunized or non-immunized in their population has developed herd immunity against COVID-19 virus. And when you induce newer strains in your body, if you're infected or non-infected, it is going to develop mutation, because immune system is so complex, which nobody can understand. Then if at all we have understood the immune system so clearly, we would not have had this problem right now what we are facing. And there is two type of immune system, like acquired and innate immune system. One is which we have from birth. Another one is the acquired immunity, which we get once we go through different types of infection. And you should get infected to develop immunity against that particular organism. You cannot inject immunity into your body, because when you get infected, it is an environmental choice. When you get injected and take that immunity, it is a choice of yours, which your body need to respond in a favorable way. And all the virus which we have is one single trick can invade your immune system, and it can become more virulent, which can develop problems for all of us. So here, the problem which we are facing in COVID-19 is most of the immune system hike. There is a cytokine storm. There is an increased activity of the immune system, which is working like an autoimmune system. Like it is destroying its own cells. It is destroying our lungs. It is destroying our other organs. That is why we say that people who are having comorbidities like diabetes or hypertension or any kind of disease are more vulnerable for such kind of disease, because their immune system is compromised. That is compromised because of an irrational approach. That is not the part of today's talk, so I'm just restricting myself from going there. So what I want to understand is, like, our systems or our treatment approaches should be something futuristic, not reductionist and knee-jerk reaction to the current infection what we are getting, and we are finding some alternatives to what others are doing. We are not here to finding alternatives to hydrochloroquine or alternatives to find ivermectin or something like that. We are here to provide sustainable healthcare model to the people rather than disease-centric model to the people. And if the vaccinations or if the health system is so powerful, there is a question raised by Frontiers of Immunology journal, Bloom D. et al. Infectious disease threat in 21st century, strengthening the global response was the paper which they discussed. If the effective protection is offered by this kind of immunization or this kind of different kind of antibiotics or things like that, why we are getting, in the last 10 years, there was Ebola, there was Zika, there was dengue, Middle East respiratory syndrome, and now we have SARS as well as influenza. Why there is a rise in these kind of conditions? Why there is a rise in the infectious disease suddenly? If you see, the immunization schedule in India started with 8 vaccines. Right now, we are reaching up to 26 to 29 vaccinations. And developed countries are much faster than that. They have 93 vaccines in the United States of America. They have even vaccines against influenza. And we are not learning from our repeated failures. We should understand only the names are changing, the organisms are same. They are either virus or a bacteria or a fungi. So there is some problem with our approach. There is some problem with how we approach towards this infectious disease. And you see, this is a 2000 published paper in American Journal of Public Health, where they spoke about making a germ panic then and now. The first germ panic, the panic towards the germs or infection, started with the acceptance of germ theory of disease, which was never accepted by yoga and naturopathy community. And then there were a lot many theories created around, because microbiology department has to sustain, virology department has to sustain. There are a lot many panic situation created around germs. Germs are looked as our enemies. And this so much this germ panic has raised. If we are now, we are in a situation, if we touch another person, if we touch a person who a paper of money, if we touch the library book, if we touch the common drinking cups, this is represented as a potential carrier of infection. And dust and infects are scared as infectious agent. A clothing, a sneeze, everything is scared. There is a lot of scariness created around the germs. And if you see the number of sanitizer bottle which has been sold in this particular COVID-19 pandemic, and if you go out and see any medical stores or pharmacy stores, you can see there were buckets and 5 liters, 6 liters of sanitizer available. And where we will go by killing all these germs? We cannot go anywhere. Germs are very much the inhabitant of this ecosystem and it's the universe. We have to learn and live with them. How to learn and live with them? With yoga and naturopathy interventions. So before going into yoga and naturopathy interventions, this is something which you will learn in your social and preventive medicine PSM subject in your third year or so. This is called epidemiological triad. For any causation of the disease, there are three components which is involved. One is the host, which is we ourselves as humans. Another one is agent, which can be a chemical agent, which can be a live agent like virus, bacteria, anything. Another one is the environment where the agent and the host is being present. And our major focus in yoga and naturopathy is on the host and the environment. We hardly care about the agent, because we believe in keeping, it's not about belief, the evidence behind what we believe is about keeping the host up to mark and the environment favorable for the host, not the agent. So any infectious disease will not affect that host who is in a perfect conducive environment. And if you see the other system, they look for the physical parameters, increased SpO2 levels, increased oxygen saturation, increased blood sugar, reduced blood sugar level, reduced blood pressure level. We see that as a coexistence or a co-effect of whatever we give with. And that is what salutogenic approach of naturopathy is propagating for. And if you see the other systems of medicine, like majorly modern medical system focuses on the agent. If you see the most of the ICMR Institute, they are named after a disease or an agent. National Institute of Tuberculosis, National Institute of Leprosy, National Institute of Virology, National Institute of Liver Diseases, they are all named after diseases. Are we here to propagate disease-centric approach? Are we here to promote more fear and scariness among the people? Then who will promote the health? Who is potential enough, whose system is potent enough to promote this health? It is yoga and naturopathy system along with other Ayush medical system. For that, the first approach which we need to give is the vitality, which is the basic principle which you learn. So scientifically, what is vitality? So vitality is not immunity. Vitality is not the prana or something which we just read in yoga philosophy. Vitality is simply described as the ability to adapt and self-manage. If you lose a limb, if you get liver cirrhosis, if you get cancer, still the ability of your body or your mind to adapt and to self-manage and promoting a positive health approach rather than a disease healing approach, that is called vitality. And there are two components in vitality, that is a mental component as well as a physical component. The mental component is nothing but being resilient to everything, like hearing the bombardment of news from different people, hearing different doctors giving advices on how a diabetes person will die faster than a normal person. All these are negative approaches which will affect our mental equilibrium and our perseverance. So vitality is something which we promote in our health seeker, where they are mentally strong against all these odd propagandas. The second one is the physical vitality, where you have higher energy levels. You have seen people who are 90-year-old, 100-year-old, who are very active because their vitality is very high. And you have also seen people who are 35 who are lethargic because their vitality level is very, very low. So based on scientific literature, the vitality has three dimensions. One is energy, that is feeling energized by yourself, like you are energetic to do anything. Even if you have COVID, you are able to attend your sessions, you are able to give your talks, you are able to do your work. And motivation for setting goals in life and putting effort towards achieving them. The goals are not to get diabetes, not to get COVID, or not to get hypertension. The goals are being well, being a part of wellness spectrum, even though if you have some kind of illness. Falling ill is a part of wellness. And to be resilient. Resilience is something like ability to deal with everyday problems, the ability to deal with all the stressor and challenges in the life. And this is a beautiful paper which you can download, the core dimensions of vitality, Dutch vitality scale measurement, which speaks more about this particular vitality. So now coming back to yoga and naturopathy, and yoga, I won't be speaking much because naturopathy is the topic which is given to me. And yoga and naturopathy as a system of medicine does not ever speak about the disease management. Disease management is a co-action of all the yoga and naturopathy physicians. We always try and approach the human body in its entirety. For us, liver cirrhosis is not just the problem of the liver. It has something to do with your digestive system. It has something to do with your cognition, your acceptance of what environment you are being in. It has something to do with how you breathe in and breathe out. It has something to do with how you are interacting with your external environment. And the basic philosophy of naturopathy is something that we promote our own healing capacity, where the doctor's role is just being a teacher. And we need to have host-friendly treatment measures. It is not that you take this particular drug, it may have some side effects, but the benefits from this particular drug is overweighing the risk which is having. That is how vaccines or any kind of antibiotics is being promoted. An antibiotic is being promoted by saying that though it erodes your 100% of your gut flora, it will prevent against the symptoms like a throat pain or a diarrhea or a vomiting or some rashes which you got because some viral agent has become virulent, because you allowed it to become virulent. We don't go with such kind of approach. We pacify the virus as well as the host at the same time by our external treatment, which is not only the tub baths or water baths, or which is also the counseling which we give to our patients. And this is a paper which we have published in 2014 in Focus on Alternative and Complementary Medicine Therapies, where we have spoken extensively about how this particular philosophy, which is built for naturopathy, is going to help in health-centric practices rather than disease-centric practices. And also when we speak about naturopathy modalities, I recommend this particular paper, Naturopathy and Primary Care Practice, which is written by Fleming et al., where they speak about how our five element theory is being, like most of our treatments are based on either air or water or some kind of energy mechanisms. And we have a comprehensive energy treatment methodology in terms of fasting, which we say the first line management of a treatment in naturopathy, diet therapy, hydrotherapy, heliotherapy, and the unique combination of yoga and naturopathy, which takes care of the mental insufficiencies and strengthens the body and promotes healing. And never ever as a yoga naturopathy physician promote something like a single centric practice, like acupuncture is good for headache or hip bath is good for alleviating your digestive disorders. Don't go with a single centric approach. This is a problem which we have developed, acquired problem which we have developed just because of the fact that we are adapting the pathology textbook too much, and we are more of a physiological system rather than a pathology-oriented system. So let us embrace the pathology away, and let us embrace the physiology into our practice, where we use our interventions more physiologically than with a pathological approach. And going further, if you go with the host immunity and COVID-19, if you speak, there are a lot of papers available on host immunity and COVID-19, but none of the paper discusses on that. If you see, yoga and naturopathy system of medicine is a system of medicine. which operates on the principle of salutogenesis. Salutogenesis is nothing but the concept which embraces human health rather than focusing on disease. And there are a lot of papers coming in, medical literature coming in on salutogenic approach towards healthcare. And naturopathy is already doing that. Only thing, we are not speaking in that terminology, is we are not embracing it continuously. We are either giving yoga separately, or we are either giving diet separately or acupuncture separately. The integration is not happening. And why we are giving this treatment? If you take a COVID-19 patient and if you treat with steam inhalation or sun bath or any kind of that kind of sort of symptoms or things like that, what you have, we are not intervening those patients just to get rid of COVID-19. That is a major concept which we should keep. We are intervening that patient to bring a better health status, better wellness stage. Even though if he get COVID-19, even though if he get repeated infection, he'll be able to cope up with the induced vitality in his body. That should be our approach. That is what salutogenic approach is promoting for. And acquiring good natural immunity through a healthy lifestyle is a key factor for preventing infections and coexisting with the virus and bacteria around us. And if you see the standard physician manuals, like the one which we have authored, and Dr. Satyalakshmi, our director, has written Germ Theory of Disease, Vitality and Toxemia. I hope you all should have one copy of this particular textbook, and these chapters are must for read for developing our philosophical concept of naturopathy interventions. These chapters resonate that building a strong immunity in order the body to render the unfavorable environment to the pathogens. Pathogens thrive only when there is unfavorable environment. If you take a small burger, a burger kept in a refrigerator environment will never get spoiled. But expose it to a natural environment, there will be fungal infection in that. Similar thing in our body. When our body is in a proper protected environment in terms of natural protection, I'm not speaking about a vaccinated protection. When there is a natural protection, your body is in a very favorable condition for the host, not for the agent which is coming out. So that condition will be unfavorable for the pathogen to thrive. And it has been proven by repeated kind of studies. I'll show you the kind of studies which has come. So before going into the specific therapies which we recommend, especially in infectious diseases, you should understand what is the difference between pathogenesis and salutogenesis. In medical science, pathogenesis is the concept which is given much importance to understand the disease process, how the disease developed, and how the healing mechanisms can be utilized for alleviating this disease process. Whereas salutogenesis is something which contributes to the understanding and development of maintenance of health. So at this current scenario, where we have understood that our repeated measures by repeated reductionist approach, knee-jerk approaches has failed to give a complete protection or prevent infections, the only way or goal which we have ahead is to promote the maintenance of health. The maintenance of health is by increasing the curative resources. And who are the curative resources? Yoga and naturopathy physicians or the Ayush physicians. Increase the standards of the curative resources, potential for active adaptation to unaccustomed situations. This is an unaccustomed situation. Like, we have never seen a pandemic in our generation. People might have seen in their cholera, and it is a much older generations than us, but I'm sure that most of us have never seen a pandemic like this. In this kind of unaccustomed situation, when we are exposed to such kind of situation, our entire medical system, public health system in India has failed. People were roaming around with patients, and there were deathbeds set up in common grounds, and people were staying outside the wards. This is because we have not developed our body, mind, and the public health system enough to adapt to such kind of changes. And I'm very sure with the kind of reductionist approach which we are going in and putting vaccination irrationally and developing mutant strains without understanding the mechanism of the infectious disease itself, we are going to face much and many more pandemics in the future. At that point of time, the only light at the end of the tunnel is the yoga and naturopathy physicians, who are not promoted by any pharmacological companies, who are not promoted by any kind of health companies or any kind of external resources who will be paying you for your work. You are in a very best position to lead this healthcare in future. Only thing, are we ready to take it up in that way? Are we ready to speak out in terms of the medical literature which is available, which I'm just showing you, like salutogenesis, a bona fide guide towards health preservation. And we are always there for health preservation rather than for disease management. Let us promote normal deliveries. Let us promote breastfeeding. Let us promote people going outdoor and exposing their body to sun and increasing their vitamin D levels. Let us promote people going and promote people allowing their children to play in the mud and get infected and develop their acquired immune system. Can we do that as a group of medical fraternity? And coming back to the most important therapies which we need to use for the COVID-19 infections or even for the preservation of health. And these are the papers which have already shown that the intermittent fasting, as simple as sunset to dawn, like from the dawn to dusk, if you do a smaller intermittent fasting, they have a capability to upregulate the DNA repair and immune system. And this is not an animal study, it's a human-based study. And I have given the references down there. You can utilize that for your resource generation. And also the time-restricted feeding, either you having a 16 hours window between your eating and having a 6 or 7 hours window period for just eating is the key for improving the immune system dysfunction. And also fasting has shown the respiratory system specific anti-inflammatory effect, which is going to be a health promotion activity. Like if you have, like it is not like that when we do fasting, we will be just saying that this is for your lungs, this is for your brain. We don't say fasting is a generalized approach towards healthcare preservation. So when you see how scientific we are, we are scientific. There is a deliminating NLRP inflosome gene, as well as TH2 cell activation, which reduces the airway epithelial cytokine production. And cytokine storm has been one of the major problem in this particular COVID-19 pandemic. And if you see how fasting can prevent from viral infections per se, or make the virus less virulent. Virus is a parasite, and virus cannot have their nutrition from themselves. From their own cell, they cannot produce nutrition. They are always dependent upon the nutrients what the host is taking. That is you, human being. We as human being, what we take. And altering the cellular metabolism, keeping us in a very, low calorie or a calorie restricted approach, we can prevent ourselves from any kind of infections, because these parasites cannot thrive with their own nutrients. They are not capable of producing their own nutrition. And this particular study is published in PLOS in 2019. If you see, PLOS is a very good journal. Your principal would be able to explain what is PLOS. The inert meats leaving the expanding view of metabolic alterations during viral pathogenesis. It's one of the beautiful paper which you need to read, though it is an animal study. It's a beautiful paper, how virus cannot survive without the host nutrition. It is not, I'm saying that you should go under malnutrition. You can keep in minimum nutrition where it can help us to get ourselves protected and preserve our health. Next most important ignored low cost intervention is vitamin D. Vitamin D as an immunomodulator has been reckoned from a longer time, but it is not used in the public health system just because there is no profit in sun exposure, or just the vitamin D supplementation will come in 36 rupees for you. So since there is no money and it is no more a patented drug, it is a generic drug, this vitamin D is not promoted. It's okay. They are not promoting. Let us promote. The ability of vitamin D to produce cathelicidin, which is one of the rate limiting enzyme which is produced, which has an antiviral activity. And please go through this paper down here for more information on this particular vitamin D. So it is one of the important factor that we expose to sun between 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. There is a peak time where we can expose, especially in India. There is a perpendicular angle of sun rays which will be falling on our skin. And more the body parts is exposed to the sun, the more protection you get in terms of vitamin D production, as well as the other upregulation of our immune system. And when we are not using vitamin D, India is a tropical country where we have abundance of sunlight. You see what they have done in the other countries. Higher duration of sunlight exposure was related to more cases recovery from COVID-19. This is done in Indonesia, Jakarta. I'm sorry, I could not place that particular reference over here, but I can share with you. The more you are exposed to sunlight, the more faster the recovery is from COVID-19. This is a proven paper. It's done on the patients from a tertiary care setting in Jakarta, Indonesia. And there is another one paper which I've just kept over here in my footnote from American Journal of Infection. The countries which are closer to the equator have lower COVID-19 fatality rates. The number of people died because of COVID-19 in the countries nearer to equator is very less than the countries which are farther from the equator. This is just because of the fact that the sunlight UV radiation produces more vitamin D because equator gets abundance of sunlight. And this intensity of UV radiation and vitamin D production is more in the equator region. Please stop me if the time is up. I have 2-3 more slides. So this is the benefit and beauty of sun bath, which can be promoted for our own benefit. So the final one is hydrotherapy. And hydrotherapy, we majorly use simple, like you don't need tub bath or heat baths. We can promote simple hot water gargling and sipping, which is shown to alleviate the sore throat, cold and flu-like symptoms. And also hot water gargling, either with saline or without saline, either with salt or without salt, it has shown to reduce the upper respiratory tract infection. And how cost-effective such interventions can be given. And already these interventions are being given in the yoga and naturopathy settings associated with the government of Tamil Nadu. So steam inhalation, another one, anecdotal practice, which is been very helpful for clearing the mucociliary clearance as well as reduces the air getting trapped between the bronchus. When you inhale more amount of oxygen, the body is going to be more helpful. And these all are from published literature, and we are seldom promoting this. We are not using it for ourselves also. Like I got infected to COVID, I was at home, I was taking rest for myself. I exposed myself to sun for 30-40 minutes every day. And I was on a very low calorie restricted diet, and there was no feel of hunger. So until and unless my hunger is back, I was on a complete complete rest and relaxation. And I recovered in 10 days. My smell came back. There was anosmia. The smell came back. My taste came back in 10-12 days, and I was all okay. So this is a paper published by me about integrated approach of yoga and naturopathy alongside conventional care, how we can integrate yoga and naturopathy as a healthcare regimen. It is a freely available paper you can go through. So all these therapies which you promote have an immunomodulatory effect and an anti-inflammatory, antiviral and conducive mental state effect. Either yoga, let it be hydrotherapy, fasting, diet therapy or sun bath. So it strengthens the immune system, enhances the mental capacity to cope stress, that is resilience, strengthens the respiratory system and may reduce the incidence of new cases. And in the treatment, it increases the faster recovery, as you have seen in the sun bath paper, which I have presented, and provides mental support to combat anxiety and stress. To summarize, what we require as a yoga and naturopathy physician is more of a salutogenic approach. The salutogenesis is nothing but positive health, and we need to build resources around health, not the bonds against risk factors, where the entire salutogenic approach is restricted towards health promotion, where the entire pathogenic approach is towards ill health, where you provide healthcare, prevention and health protection, which is mostly based on the risk factors. And yoga and naturopathy is more of a salutogenic approach, long-term sustainable approach, and which can provide a lot of key health benefits to our inhabitants. So let us preserve health, and all the side-by-side coexisting health benefits we'll be getting, and disease mitigation also will happen through that particular salutogenic approach, which we can adapt. And thank you for the opportunity. And if there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir, for that wonderful presentation on the salutogenic approach of naturopathy and yoga. If there are any questions, kindly post in the chat box.
Pradeep.
Yes, sir.
If anyone else would like to ask some questions to Dr. Pradeep M.K. Nair.
Sir, one question, please.
Yeah, please.
Rakshit, you would like to speak something?
Yes, sir. Sir, may I know what's the preferable timing for sun bath and duration also?
Yeah. So actually, that's a very good question. So usually in naturopathy, when we were in medical schools, they were advising 8 to 10 a.m. because UV rays and all. But that was like at that point of time, our ancestors were almost exposed to 8 hours of continuous sunlight, and there were bare minimum indoor activities and all the activities were outdoor. But now the transitional changes has happened and we have found that UV rays are more beneficial. And the UV rays in Indian subcontinent, we have a more prominent UV rays and the perpendicular rays of sun between 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. And there will be a lot of production of vitamin D also during that particular duration. So it is always advisable to have the sun exposure in between 11 to 3 a.m.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions?
So if there are any questions, I'll take your pardon and to join in another one. Is that fine? Dr. Naveen?
Dr. Pradeep?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. Please do.
Okay.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Dr. Pradeep, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. Of course, your session on all these aspects where you could correlate the concepts of naturopathy with the scientific literature available with us, it is highly commendable, and our students and even other college students should utilize this kind of lectures and go through all the references what Dr. Pradeep has given. It is the innovative idea of collecting all these references. Once again, we congratulate Dr. Pradeep for that. Anything else you would like to convey to some of our students so that they could improve the basics, which we never had when we were in the first year, even you agree with me. So kindly share some of your views how they should move on. Thank you.
So what has happened in our medical education is, as I have already told, like the conflict between physiology and pathology. So we give lesser importance to the philosophical part of our studies, and we will almost forget it when you reach the final year. And it's a very bad approach because you will be just restricting yourself as a, what to say, tertiary care, rehabilitative, adjunct physician. Whereas we should want people to join with us for if they get a fever or if they get a stomach ache, if they get a diarrhea, they should be first approaching a yoga and naturopathy physician. We should convert ourselves as like a primary care physician, where we are not today. And that can be only achieved when you believe in your system of medicine. Belief doesn't mean that you should believe it blindly. There are resources, and you joining yoga and naturopathy fraternity now, you will be become our colleagues in another 5 years. Where you will be preaching and propagating the system of medicine. This is a time where you can utilize the resources, and there is a lot of resources available, and you can always communicate with us. You can take my number or anything, and you can always reach out to us. And we are also planning to have this faculty exchange programs also to be run with the help of all the colleges. So I think there will be a lot of knowledge exchange will be happening, and never feel low about the philosophical concept, or we are not having any interventions, nobody is respecting us. Nobody is respecting because they are ignorant. And who will make them aware about the system of medicine? It is the stakeholders like us. So let us speak science. Let us speak science in a very solid way with a lot of evidence available around it. Only thing, we need to be smart enough to correlate and converse the entire documentation at a place and utilize it for our benefit. And hope with all your help, we can do it together. And in the coming future, we all will have a fruitful days. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep. This is what I have been telling to our students also in my classes. What we had, you are more fortunate now, you have more evidence. And many of our professionals have become more scientific and they speak scientifically now compared to when we were there in 1998 to 2004. So still further after 20 years, we will have more evidence. Still they will have better, you know, prospects, better, but they are fortunate enough to build the confidence level with the scientific literature which is available. Anyway, with your talk has been excellent, and our students also have learned many things from this. The basics of philosophy and HAQ, which you have portrayed with the form of scientific literature. On behalf of our institution, on behalf of our Inapoya University, I thank you for being with us today on this second national symposium which you have conducted. Thank you, Dr. Pradeep.
Thank you, it's a pleasure. Thank you.